Hi everybody, Dr. Deedat Harrison here from Chiropractic Biophysics Seminars and Technique and Chiropractic Biophysics Nonprofit, our spine research presentation. Some of you might have seen this before, however, I'm updating it with some brand new information, current, contemporary, state of the art. This is our cervical dentarol presentation. We're going to go through the background, the rationale, and then indications and contraindications of applications of the cervical dentarol orthotic for patient populations. At the end, you'll see some information on billing and coding, and then you'll also see how to order this through CBP seminars and through dental industries. I'm presenting this on behalf of myself, but also my colleague, Dr. Adrian Dennewald of Sydney, Australia, who is the originator and designer of the original development of the original Dentarol. So to begin, again, I've done this before, but this is an update. These are the topics that we are going to be covering in general. You can jump back and forth between this as you're watching the content. You can fast forward and back up if you actually need to, you know, refocus on one of the topics here, or if you need, you know, to see the exact slide. If you're watching this on a DVD, I know that's old school and ancient. You can still, you know, fast forward or go backwards. So to begin, just to give you the concept, you should already know this. Why are we using the Dentarol? Well, number one, we need a prescription evidence-based orthotic to be able to hand out and prescribe to our patient populations that need rehabilitation or restoration of the cervical curve. But before we do that, that begs the question just briefly of, is there such a thing as normative data for the cervical lordosis? Now, I've done detailed presentations on this before where we cover this for 2 hours, just this topic. I don't want to do that. I just want to give you brief excerpts to cement the idea of what a normal curve is with a little bit of research. And then if you're brand new, you'll get the concept of wow, this is really, truly an evidence-supported topic, right? So the idea out there that cervical kyphosis or straight necks are normal for you, that's really absurd in my opinion. As one of the foremost published authors on this topic in the literature, what is a normal curve? What happens when you don't have a normal curvature? Arguably, I have more publications on that topic in the peer-reviewed literature than the majority of researchers out there. So I would say I'm actually one of the premier experts on this. So my perspective is there is a normal alignment for the cervical curve. My group has modeled this starting in the 1990s with my late father, Dr. Don Harrison, DC, PhD, master's degree in mechanical engineering. We developed and tested earlier models, but then refined them and developed our own model for the cervical curvature. What we know today is it should be represented by a smooth rate of curvature. A circular geometry is the best representation for the cervical curve in the sagittal plane. And this is along the posterior vertebral body margins. So the back of the vertebral bodies along this green line or my laser light, a smooth rate of curvature means for each height of the column, it has the same angle of curvature. So a circle has a uniform rate of curvature. And we've modeled the cervical lordosis with a piece of a circle. What that means is all the joints in the cervical spine should be closely the same angle when we look at their relative rotation angles or their juxtapositions. Now, C2 is an exception because C2 is a slightly bigger bone. So we expect about a degree to a degree and a half more curvature at the C2, C3 relative rotation angle or segmental angle. Also, the atlas plane line, slightly different. We don't have a vertebral body there, so of course we make a different measurement there. And then the skull being very unique sitting on the atlas. So we know those are two different areas. So I don't want to talk a lot about that in this context, although I want to allude to it. The atlas plane line is extended on C2. We know how much or approximately how much. And the skull is actually flexed on the atlas. So we have an upper cervical, if you will, flexion, but that's really the skull flexed on the atlas. Here's our original model. This model was published in mathematical journals in Proceedings of Math Conferences in the early 1990s, and it was also published in Spine 1996, the March edition. So our model is a height divided by length model. It is not a radius model. It is a height divided by length model, and we get a ratio of the height over length, and then we can calculate total angles of curvature, and we can calculate segmental angles of curvature. We use the posterior vertebral body margin analysis. We use this for two reasons. Number one, it's very reliable between and within examiners, and number two, it represents the exact angle of curvature using a slope analysis or the first derivative in calculus. So the back of the vertebral body margins, we call it the posterior body tangent method. And it's based on how much translation they really have, and of course their tolerance. So the reality of it is, I'm here to tell you, you need an x-ray to prescribe this orthotic and tell somebody where to use it. And we'll talk about this coming up. But I want to say this, certain boards, not to name names, the British Columbia of Chiropractic Association, they put it in writing. They said that they actually took a scientific committee and they would not allow Dentarol and CBP to advertise a continuing education course to their membership because they said we did not fit the scientific credibility and criteria of what they're looking for. And of course we rebutted that. And they overturned that, but they said this, and I'm sorry for calling you out, this is the way it is. I'm gonna speak the truth, and I've got the email documentation exactly from them, and I can show you what they said. Please be advised, you need to tell your attendees and your membership that x-ray is not mandatory as part of this technique and part of this system to prescribe the Dentarol orthotic. I look at that and I go, you gotta be kidding me. So, okay, here's my answer to that. I'm gonna give chiropractors two choices. You can either prescribe the Dentarol orthotic, the location, its placement, and its size based on radiographic evidence and patient pain syndromes to determine exactly where and how to use it and how much care they need and make sure that they actually need the device and that you're not making their condition worse. Or you can use your magic fingers and determine what their spine shape is and if they have a curve and where they need to do it. So there's your two choices, chiropractors. We either can use evidence-based, gold standard, valid imaging, or we can guess and be a guesser. So we'll call it a guess-a-practor. So there's your two choices. Back to this. People say, well, Deed, you're a little too harsh. That's why not too many people are doing CBP. And you know what? Harshness is needed in this case. Like, let's grow up, let's be mature, we're professionals. Just for a second, just imagine this. Imagine going to a dentist and the dentist says, I think you need a root canal, but you know what? I'm gonna look at it and I'm gonna guess and we'll see exactly what's going on and we'll give you a root canal. Or you know what, I could image it and I could see, do you actually have an infection and cavity that goes all the way down into the jaw and you actually are a candidate for a root canal. Which one of those would you like me to do? You're like, no dentist would ever give those two choices. You would image or you would not get a root canal. Anyway, back to this. C7, T1 body tangent to vertical. We are going to use this measurement to determine whether or not A, somebody needs the Dentarol down in their lower cervical spine, or B, what exactly is happening to the upper thoracic spine? Do we need to image the thoracic spine too? So the C7 body tangent tells me where I'm gonna use the Dentarol and what problem with a translation I have or hyperkyphosis. Ideal values for the T1 body tangent, so it's the back of T1 relative to a vertical line that originates at the posterior inferior corner of T1. The angle right there should be in the mid-20s. That angle in the literature now is clearly established. We did this way back when, but now you're seeing spine surgeons, neurosurgeons, and orthopedic surgeons and researchers around the world testing this, and it's got a normal range of 20 to 40 degrees. And we showed that the ideal model was 26.5 degrees, so we say in the mid-20s. Now, if you're under 20, it means you have a flattening of the upper thoracic curvature, and we're really gonna place the Denerol down there in the low neck. If you're above 40, it means you have major anterior head translation and you have hyperkyphosis, and you may actually not need the Denerol. So it's really one of our indicators for do you need the Denerol or not. If somebody's over 40 degrees with this, we need to take a mid and upper thoracic lateral x-ray and really the whole thoracic spine to see, do we have hyperkyphosis of the thoracic spine? Above 40 degrees is major anterior head translation or hyperkyphosis, and the Denerol is not so good at improving those situations. Now you could say, well, let me put the Denerol, a small one, in the mid-cervical spine to try to improve the curve in those cases that are above 40 degrees, but we really have to rule other things out. So this becomes an important measurement too, and guess what? You can't use your magic fingers and eyeball it. You actually have to image it and assess it and see what's happening, okay? So it says here, you have hypokyphosis if I'm under 20, and you have hyper if I'm above 40, okay? Values greater than those above indicate, or excuse me, less than those above indicate the need for the cervical Denerol, okay? If values are more than 40 degrees, again, we're gonna be very cautious and pretty much not use it. Each Denerol comes with a user guide. So, okay, now why the 10 to 20 mark for extension traction? It's basically viscoelastic fluid properties. It's a topic that's called fluid flow of material, and it's called biorheology, okay? So when I look at spine tissues, discs, ligaments, muscles, nerves, they're viscoelastic. What that means is the amount of deformation that the tissue undergoes is load dependent, rate of the applied load dependent, like how fast you apply the load, how much load you apply, and then also the time of the load. And of course, the angle that we apply this load in. But what I can control is, I can control how much load and how much time, and I'm not so concerned about the rate of the applied load. We're not talking about an injury on the Denerol, we're talking about gently laying over it. So when I look at fluid mechanics and I look at viscoelastic material mechanics, I understand that time is a very important thing for tissue elongation, or what we call viscoelastic deformation. So this is a graph out of my cervical rehab book in chapter 6. This shows me the time on traction on the Denerol or any extension traction device in the office. And then this shows me the extension creep deformation versus the range of motion. And really what's happening is, as I hold the tissue in an extended position for 5 minutes. Denerol, very important. So example, here's a pre-x-ray taken July 6, 2005 by my good friend Joe Ferrantelli. Now look, I have a straightening of the mid cervical curve, a real mild kyphosis at C4, C5, and then dramatic extension above that. In fact, too much extension at Atlas C2. This has been there a long time, the degeneration down low. Now, I'd like to place the Denerol down low here, but the deal is, lo and behold, the person doesn't really commit to care. They come back in 2010, about 5 years later, they were in a motor vehicle crash collision. Look what happened to their cervical spine. Does it have a similar shape? Yes. It's worse though, look. Boy, instability now at 4-5 and way forward, 4-5 is an anterolisthesis there. This is not a healthy shape in the neck. 5-6 is kyphotic, 4-5 is kyphotic. And then again, look at the C1, C2 extension. Here's the deal. I put this person on the Denerol. Here's the stress x-ray. Following this, I see dramatic improvement in all the variables, but I have too much extension in the upper cervical spine. So the mistake here is, I want the Denerol lower in the neck, and I want to allow that C4, C5 joint to come back even further. And then what I want is I want the person to do a little chin tuck on the Denerol. So I'm going to use the medium device in the low neck, not here. Look at the shadow of the Denerol. It's really at almost C4. I actually want it a little bit lower. So if you've never taken stress films of people on the X, this is Dr. Cindy Boyd presenting her case as a CBP doctor, her personal experience. She's got a black eye and it's all swollen here, and she's with her two brothers, amazing young men, and they are chefs. And if you ever get down to the Bay Area in Alameda, Oakland, her brother runs an awesome little restaurant down there. It was on Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives, awesome. So check them out. But Cindy Boyd, she has the shiner because she was in a mountain bike accident, and she flew and hit her head and hit the eye, but screwed up the cervical spine. She was also in a snowboard accident. The deal is, lots of neck pain issues, headache issues, heart palpitations. We always fill out the neck disability index and the SF-36, and she's got scores that are below population averages. We want to track people's health and well-being, and we want to track their pain and disability, and these are the questionnaires we do this. The Dennerl randomized trials, we've tracked this stuff, and we know that we're improving people's neck pain and disability and overall function and health. But look at Cindy's x-ray. The deal is, she's got a very bad cervical curve. She's got a retrolisthesis C5-6, disc herniation there for sure. I'll show you the MRI. Kyphosis there, degeneration there. Look at the C3, C4 joint. It's a retrolisthesis. And then, of course, C2, C3 is in hyperextension and starting to look like a mild retrolisthesis. Posture Ray gives me the numbers. 18 degrees, not acceptable, C2, C3. That's an instability. C4, C5 reaches the absolute threshold for instability. It's above 3.5 millimeters. So what I want to do is, I want to be very careful with hyperextension in the upper neck in Cindy's case. We take flexion extension films, and lo and behold, too much angle C2, C3, retrolisthesis gets worse of C3 on C4. I don't like what I'm seeing here. MRI, notice disc herniation 3-4, mild bulge at 4-5, and then 5-6, very significant herniation. In evidence, can we actually make the claim that it improves the neck curve and head posture and patient relevant outcomes? The cool thing is that Dennerl fits the bill. It's the only orthotic like this that has truly been shown through randomized trials to actually fit the bill. And it is truly an evidence-based prescription orthotic. And I think you need to understand that and communicate along those lines. It will make a difference in your patient practices or your patient outcomes and your clinical practice. You're going to add this as one of your clinical tools in your armamentarium of what you do with people. And I did not stutter. Armamentarium is a real word, look it up. So the deal is, we want you on board with this, using this properly. It requires x-ray unless you can palpate the shape of the curve and any instability and the C7, T1 body tangent, etc. So let's use this in a proper scientific manner. Let's use it as a prescription home orthotic, and let's get you on board with a Dennerl as a Dennerl prescriber. Thank you for your time and attention.